I just wanna watch the shtick. I really get a kick out of it. They don't ever miss.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's theater. Sick of my
shtick. Hi, welcome to the shtick. Today we're joined by Russell, Eva, Barry, yes, and George Cass on the end. And as Rusty just said, we're talking about theater.
Theater.
An exciting topic.
Very exciting. Let me welcome George, because you're new to the show. What is your relationship with theater?
Well, Barry and I have co-written and conceived a dance musical.
Okay.
Yes.
An original production, but using existing music.
A songbook musical.
Songbook musical. In its true sense.
That is very
exciting. Explain what a songbook musical is.
Yeah.
In the biz, as we call it. A songbook musical is taking existing music and building a story around it, somewhat like Mamma Mia and Jersey Boys, which is coming. Not writing music specifically for the story for the musical, but songbook, or sometimes it's called jukebox musical.
What inspired you to do this?
George had the idea of it. George had worked in TV production for many years, and he was also very involved in Latin dance music. What did you, George?
Well, I started ballroom dancing on television in Australia in 1990 on the 7 Network. And so my background is Latin dancing. And there hadn't been a true musical, songbook musical, using Latin themes, Latin music and Latin dancing. So we built a story around that.
Nice.
And so you found that, how has it been difficult being in Australia to get this off the ground?
Well, you know, it's an interesting process. There are different levels of acceptability, and it's about, at one stage of it, it's about the idea. Mm. So if the concept is right, and I think our concept is pretty good, and the acceptance within the industry has been very good from directors and some producers and a number of people, but it's so hard to get a show that's like ours is a very large scale show. So it's, the larger the scale of the show, the harder it is to put in a country like Australia.
And musicals are now having a bit of a resurrection at the moment. This time, because there was a time, you know, that it has its ups and downs.
Yes.
And at the moment, you think.
Did you say erection?
Hopefully yours will be one of those, but yes, we'll see.
I'm going to ask Russ.
Yes.
Now, you play piano. Have you done any work with musical theatre?
Not with musical theatre, actually. I've done work with acting, but not actually ever involved in musicals, strangely enough. Probably because I couldn't be bothered learning the entire score or having to work
on it. So what I'm hearing is
laziness that dictated the order of the day. Though.
But that begs the question about what it is that we find, you know, when you say theatre, we're talking about theatre here, do we tend to default to musical theatre, or is it drama, or is it one-man shows?
Is it pole dancing? Is it coin flop shows?
When I think of theatre, I think of a straight play or a play that doesn't necessarily have music in it.
Yeah. George, you would probably naturally think of...
Well, my forte and my pleasure is musical theatre.
So that where you think of theatre, you think of Sound of Music or Latin Heat, great. Wait for it's coming.
Or cabaret.
At least there's a bit of excitement about something that sounds like Latin Heat, as opposed to a lot of musicals that I would say, no, I can't go to that. I'd be absolutely yawning and falling asleep by an entire night of singing.
That was yawning and sleeping.
Oh, a long time ago. I cannot remember. Something classical that really was just nauseating singing, almost as bad as opera, which I can't stomach.
The ones I've been to, it tends to be the your staples, your Les Mis, your Phantom, your producers. I went years ago to see...
Yeah, they're all the ones that put me to sleep.
Aida at Princess Park, which was terrible with the elephants and the horses and the camels, and you couldn't hear anything. It was an Egyptian. It was awful.
Well, opera's theatre too, isn't it?
Yeah, I hate opera.
Well, there you go.
Some of it's good, but more of that later. Let's see what the rabbi has to say.
Absolutely.
Last week on the shtick, I spoke about movies, cinema, and why you shouldn't go, or at least why I don't go. But theater and cabaret, that's another thing, because that is like real life. That is utilizing human talent for music, for unbelievable entertainment, for skill. That is what we go to see, and that is what people can love. You know, the Jews have got a long history of involvement with theater. Jewish theater in Poland, where I come from, it was fantastic. The most exciting, the most wondrous, the most captivating. And that is where I believe that we should be heading back. Some of the young entertainers who you will see on the rest of the show this week, they are keeping alive the tradition, the history, and the wonderment of theatrical life. I myself, if I would have had that choice between being a rabbi and being an entertainer on the stage, I think I would have chosen the latter. But everybody, they still want to come and see me. I've got a guaranteed audience every week. In the synagogue, they come, they listen. They might sleep, but they still come. Have a good week.
Rabbi is a genius. He always has pearls of wisdom. I hope we can all take it on board, especially you this week, especially you. But as mentioned, we're at Temple Beth Israel today, and why are we here?
We're here to talk to and to see a bit of a rehearsal of a cabaret, which is being performed by the Jewish...
A progressive new...
Well, it's their take on the subject, no, as a producer
has told me. Which production?
Cabaret, Sally Bowles.
Produced by...
In the Kit Kat Club, produced by a wonderful girl called Shlom Eshel, who's started up the Jewish Youth Musical Theatre Company. Cool. So we'll be talking to Brendan Cohen, the director of this show, and to Ruth Yaffe, who's one of the actors in the show.
But Jews and musicals, Jews and theatre. What gives?
It's a funny thing. I mean, different sort of experiences. American theatre, heavily influenced by Jews, both as writers, producers,
actors.
Irving Berlin. Rodgers and Hammerstein, famous.
Absolutely.
Immigrants from Russia.
The Gershwins?
Some of them come from the Yiddish theatre, progressed onto off Broadway, etc.
All
vaudeville type.
Long history of it. We're here in Australia, it's a very different history, little in the way of mainstream.
Well,
you have Barry Kosky and you've had
Ron Alicia
to a lesser degree.
Done some terrific things, yeah.
A much lesser degree, maybe because the immigration to Australia was much more oriented post-war, different experience, and different group. Haven't had the length
of
time.
There were a lot of Jews there pre-war who already had honed their skills.
Absolutely, and a lot of Yiddish theatre. And then there's been a lot of amateur or semi-professional.
I just want to ask the panel, do you think a play or a musical having a Jewish theme, Jewish people tend to go and see it more than a non-Jewish thing?
Depends what it is. Fiddler on the Roof,
yeah, but if you
example,
put Fiddler on
well, the great, greatest ever.
Perhaps the older generation would be drawn more, that the younger generation would be more discerning and choose if they like it first.
Yeah. I'd rather personally something more contemporary, because it's like every Saturday night you turn on the TV to see the same movie on there again. It's like, great, how many times can you watch The Sound of Music? Enough. Something contemporary.
So you think they should be
It's hard to do something contemporary to get the audience, because unless you're a known theatre producer with a known cast of names, no one's going to come and see someone I don't know doing something I'm not sure of.
But the rehearsals we're looking at today for Cabaret, what Jewish themes are in that?
Well, it was a.
Well, it's a
good question.
It's in Germany. It's at the Kit Kat Club.
Germany.
People are there running away from something or hiding from something.
Well,
the main
it's about
character
intolerance and
isn't it pre like early
it's
1933? It's 1933.
It's as Europe was, as they say, the lights were dimming in Europe at the time, and the main character Sally Bowles has dilemma. You know, we have dilemma. She's got a German suitor that likes her, but you know, she has to, and an Englishman, and there's all sorts of personal things going on in there, so it's pretty heavy Jewish theme.
I wouldn't have thought it was German.
but that's why Jews go there because the backdrop, the backdrop
of
is
Nazi
the
Germany.
Is the Nazi
it's not, it doesn't have a Jewish
but would
theme.
Nazi
well,
Germany
but
put
Liza Minnelli
put
married
Jews
so many people and someone was
the,
Jewish.
Well,
and
I mean,
that's the
very few it, shows have got an overtly Jewish aspect to them. Fiddler on the Roof is an obvious one. The producers. Yeah. Even though the producers doesn't actually really ever say anything about being Jewish.
It's just their character.
You know it's Jewish.
It's very much.
Yeah.
We were just talking about Guys and Dolls, where I think probably I've always assumed the Nathan Detroit character in Guys and Dolls was Jewish. Never said, never expressed it in any way. A bit like watching Seinfeld on TV. Everyone thinks Jewish, but
their characters.
Yeah, the characters.
What about Oliver? Fagan?
Fagan is a Dickensian character. Rabid anti-Semite. Yeah, absolutely.
Yes.
And he makes his character a very hateful sort of
Dolly
person.
Levi from Hello Dolly. Mm.
Dolly Levi from, So there are Jewish characters coming up. Fanny Bryce,
funny
and Funny Girl.
Girl.
Jewish characters would be
one in Star Wars.
But their Jewishness isn't part of the story.
But contemporary stories, there aren't any contemporary. These are musicals or theatre from going way back.
Yeah, yeah.
There's nothing really contemporary.
We need to throw to a break, so
we'll
see you after this.
We'll be back.